Good morning, everyone. Bonjour, tout le monde. Et encore, bienvenue aux membres du public et les membres des médias. C'est toujours un gros plaisir de vous avoir ici à nos réunions et l'engagement dans notre communauté. Thank you again, members of the media, members of the public. Always a real pleasure to have you participate in our meetings and engage with our community. I'd like to take first this opportunity to thank Brian Colburn, who has now resigned from the Board of Directors to enjoy life in retirement. He's in fact leaving this weekend for 4 months down south, so we can envy him. But we want to recognize and thank Brian for his years of service on the NCC Board and for his great commitment to this National Capital Region. We'd also, Mark will be referring to this later, but acknowledge Norm Hodson, who's not here today, but he's in fact receiving an award in BC for architecture, and our friend Basil Stewart, who is dealing with health issues in PEI. À ce point-ci, j'aimerais ça féliciter la maire, Pedno Jobin. Félicitations sur votre victoire d'élection. On est très, très content de vous avoir ici à la table. Continuez votre rôle sur la commission. Alors, félicitations et un gros merci. Très beau. I'd also like to recognize Mayor Watson and the tremendous work him and his team across the region are doing this week with Grey Cup. It's a very festive week with a lot of activity happening, and it's another feather and cap for the National Capital Region. So congratulations to both our mayors for the great 150 activities and the ongoing successes in this region. The last 2 months since we last met have actually, in fact, been very, very busy months. Mark, as you will see from Mark's report on activities, from the chair's perspective, the first couple of months in this role was really dealing with a lot of the internal and getting briefed and familiar with a lot of the files. The last couple of months have really been the reverse, and it's been a strong focus on engaging with our external audiences, our key stakeholders, from the elected officials to community leaders to visits in our Algonquin communities, and really deepening the collaboration and the engagement with our key stakeholders in this community to continue to enhance how we can improve the National Capital Region and continue to evolve and improve the National Capital Commission. So it's, I won't go into the details, Mark will be certainly covering most of those, but in those engagements we learn a lot and we ask a lot of questions, questions are asked of us, we find out a lot of opinions and great ideas on how to, you know, continue to improve and move forward. It's been a great opportunity for us to define and deepen the collaboration in this region. We also, last September, subsequent to the board meeting, had a strategic retreat for 2 days, and it was my first retreat as chair. And during the session, the board established the NCC's strategic directions and priorities for the upcoming planning period of 2018 to 2023. And in particular, the board worked to refresh the NCC's three strategic directions to establish clear linkages to the main goals of the plan for Canada's capital, and to update the NCC's priorities and put distinct emphasis on addressing the recommendation of the Office of the Auditor General's Special Examination Report 2017 as it pertains to asset maintenance. Now, the NCC management continues to work towards a corporate plan that reflects those strategic directions and priorities, as well as alignment with government priorities that will be presented to the board for approval in January. So thank you very much again to my board colleagues, the mayors, the leadership team from the NCC for what I found to be a very collaborative and great discussions and a real focus on the continued enhancement of the NCC and the National Capital Region. As we've talked a lot about in the last few months, the goal of organizational excellence is a continuous journey of improvement and continuous focus on doing things better and growing as a community. And so we're very excited as a board to be embarking on these strategic priorities and focus. At this point in time, I would like to ask for the adoption of our agenda. Lisa, seconded by Michael, and all in favor. Great, thank you. Declaration of any conflicts of interest. No, if there are none, great, thank you. Et l'adoption du procès verbal de la dernière séance. Okay, pour bouger.
Chairman, there are no errors or omissions in those minutes, so I would move their adoption.
Merci, Kay. Victor, tout en faveur. Oui, merci.
Business arising.
Oui, est-ce qu'il y a des affaires découlant du procès verbal? Oui, Kay.
Just two items, Mr. Chairman. On page 6 of the minutes, under the renewal of the NCC's environmental strategy, there was a reference in the minutes that the NCC should be more proactive in informing the public of its commitment towards the environment. I would just like to point out that on Thursday, November 16th, we had an absolutely fascinating session in the Urbanism Lab called Public Science at the NCC. It was excellent presentations on Emerald Ash Borer, another one on the research in Gatineau Park, and a third one on the Mare Blue. And I've lived here all of my life, and I found out things about the Mare Blue that I didn't know about. So compliments to those who organize this informative session, because they are really making a reality of the point that we made in the minutes of the last meeting. So I wanted to point that out. There are opportunities in the Urbanism Lab for people to learn a great deal about what we're doing. And the second point I wanted to raise, and I think the chair, the CEO, is going to comment on it, on page 8, when we had a motion to defer the decision of the National Memorial to Canada's mission in Afghanistan, and I understand Dr. Christensen is going to comment on that in his report, so I don't need to say any more. I just want to flag it that is business arising from the minutes.
Thank you, Kay. Any other comments? Thanks, Kay, for your passion and participation at these sessions at the Urbanism Lab. And as you mentioned, it is a great opportunity for the members of the community to continue to engage. And it is part of our focus on collaborating and great, you know, having deeper engagement across our community. So thank you for raising that, Kay. À ce point-ci, j'aimerais tourner la parole à Dr. Mark Christensen pour nous donner un rapport sur les activités.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, et bienvenue. Welcome, everyone, to this public meeting of the NCC's Board of Directors, Kwe Kakina. I'd also like to welcome everyone who is watching us via the live stream on YouTube. We are nearing the culmination of the sesquicentennial celebrations of 2017. We have a number of program elements yet to come that I'll mention later. But as we Canadians do feel the change of season, we feel winter coming on, and new things come with the winter, including the Rideau Canal Skateway, and the staff have begun preparing for that. And you will have seen the Christmas lights going up along Confederation Boulevard. And so as we approach the end of the year, I'd just like to say I'm very proud of the projects and initiatives that the NCC teams have worked hard on for several years and through this year. I think they've been appreciated by residents of the capital, and they will be have legacies that run for years to come. Je veux souligner les félicitations à Mère Pednaud-Jobin et félicitez-vous pour votre leadership. Et aussi, je veux aussi féliciter le mairesse de Chelsea, Carol Green, pour sa réélection. Nous avons hâte de travailler avec deux nouvelles figures en Outaouais, le nouveau maire de la pêche, Guillaume Lamareux, et la nouvelle mairesse de Pontiac, Joanne Labadie. J'aimerais aussi profiter de l'occasion pour remercier Robert Boussière et Roger Larose pour leur dévouement envers leur collectivité et le capital et leur amitié pendant leur période en mer. Mais, ils ont été de solides collaborateurs et partenaires et nos meilleures voies de réussite les accompagnent dans leurs futures activités. The NCC's role in the capital includes fostering and inspiring design excellence So I was delighted that our work and some of that of our partners was recognized by the City of Ottawa and the City's Urban Design Awards. Two NCC projects received awards of merit. Pindigan Park, this is the park just across from the War Museum and the National Holocaust Monument, which was designed with the Kitiganzibi Algonquin community, and also the Canadian Building Trades Monument in Majors Hill Park. So congratulations and thanks to everyone involved in those projects. Nos félicitations vont aussi au Centre mondial du pluralisme, un des pavillons de la Confédération de la CCN, et au Musée des sciences et de la technologie qui ont aussi reçu un prix du mérite. Là encore, il s'agit des solides partenaires et collaborateurs avec qui nous avons travaillé au cours des dernières années, spécialement en 2017. Finally, the National Arts Center received a top award for its rejuvenation project and for the Kipnis Lantern, which I understand will go live on New Year's Eve, and we're looking forward to that. So thank you, Mayor Watson, to you and your staff for supporting and recognizing design excellence and great urban design in the city. As our chair mentioned, Norman Hodson of Vancouver isn't with us today because he's receiving the Architectural Institute of British Columbia's Lifetime Achievement Award. Norm has been a great contributor to Canada through the NCC for a couple of decades now through the ACPADAR committee and through sitting on the board. So from our perspective, this is a great honor that is well deserved. Enfin, j'aimerais aussi féliciter le Conseil tribal des Algonquins de Kitiganzibi pour avoir donné corps à une idée que le chef Jean-Guy White Duck, le chef Kirby White Duck et moi-même avions eue il y a plusieurs années. L'idée était d'honorer un grand leader algonquin, le chef Tessouat, qui avait fait la rencontre de Samuel de Champlain en 1613. À ce moment-là, le chef Tessouat lui avait refusé le passage vers le nord. Le monument au chef Tessouat a été dévoilé le 9 novembre sur un de nos terrains à proximité du Musée canadien de l'histoire et je vous invite à aller voir ce nouvel élément de commémoration dans notre paysage. I must also share some sad news, the passing in early November of Donald Graham. Donald was a pioneering landscape architect with the NCC, whose legacies include the design of the Garden of the Provinces and Territories. On behalf of the board, I'd like to offer my condolences to Don's wife, Ray, their children and their grandchildren, as well as Don's sister. I'll now proceed with my report, once again organizing the items according to the NCC's six corporate priorities. The first of which is to facilitate and support Le Breton Flats and the islands in becoming a signature destination of national significance. I'm able today to inform the board members that the National Capital Commission and Rendezvous Le Breton Group have met frequently through the fall to advance the negotiations regarding the group's proposal for the Le Breton Flats. There has been progress, and I look forward to bringing a full report of these discussions as well as my discussions with Algonquin leaders to the January board meeting. With regard to the islands, I'd like to thank the community of Pequawknagon for hosting one of our Confederation pavilions on Victoria Island this fall. It's been very rewarding to work with Chief Kirby White Duck, his council, elders, and youth at Pequawknagon to create this Kabishinanminitig Pavilion, which is the Algonquin name for Victoria Island. Je vous entendrai plus en détail du programme un peu plus tard. Pour l'instant, je dirais seulement que leur présence sur l'île Victoria et cet étalage de tradition, d'histoire, de culture et d'art algonquin sont insufflés une belle vitalité sur l'île et créent un espace propice d'autres rassemblements de genre, une tendance qui, je crois, se maintiendra au fil des ans. Félicitations à la collectivité algonquin pour avoir fait de cet événement une telle réussite. Our second priority is to offer public access and new connections for Canadians to discover the shorelines and waterways. you'll recall we had serious flooding in the capital this spring, which was followed by heavy rains in October. All of this created damage to roads, trails, pathways, including properties in Gatineau Park and the Greenbelt. We're continuing to assess the damage and work with our engineers to address the most critical problems. In some cases, the damage will require more complex responses. Par exemple, nous n'avons pas été en mesure de réouvrir le tronçon de sentier des voyageurs entre le Musée canadien de l'histoire et le pont portage endommagé le printemps dernier. Ces travaux nécessiteront des approbations et la collaboration de plusieurs instances gouvernementales en plus d'une évaluation environnementale et d'une conception plus détaillée. However, you'll be pleased to know that the pathway behind Parliament Hill, a heavily used pathway, was reopened ahead of schedule on November 10th, and that the damaged sections have been rebuilt to a higher standard of resilience. In total, the repairs required after the spring floods will cost approximately $3.4 million, but now with additional funding required for the repairs necessitated by the most recent storm. Our third priority is to modernize the NCC's planning framework and to renew the long-term plan for Gatineau Park. I can report to the board a very rewarding series of experiences across the country as I traveled with some staff to four Canadian capitals. We started in Charlottetown, went to Quebec City, Toronto, and Victoria to check back in with Canadians regarding the results of the Plan for Canada's Capital, to which they had contributed so much over the previous years. À Charlottetown, notre conversation a tourné autour de l'aménagement des secteurs riverains. À Québec, nous avons parlé de conservation du patrimoine. In Toronto, we talked about sustainable transportation and urban forests. While in Victoria, we focused on reconciliation with Indigenous peoples of Canada and how they are moving really beyond that to what someone in our staff called reconciliation, which I thought was an interesting neologism. I would like to thank our resident liaison officer, Elder René Tenasco from the Kitiganzibi community for preparing tobacco offerings, which I presented to the Indigenous leader from each community as an acknowledgement of their welcoming us on their traditional territories. This set the stage for engaged conversations. Thank all of those who participated with thoughtful contributions. J'ai été ravi de voir tant des gens se présenter aux séances de rencontre et aussi de voir la qualité des intervenants. L'expérience m'a persuadé qu'il y a un peu partout au pays un intérêt pour une démarche collaborative avec la participation de tous les Canadiens et Canadiennes pour construire la capitale du pays. We will seek to continue this engagement with Canadians in their home regions whenever the opportunity arises. I'd like to thank very much the board members who were able to join us, Lisa McDonald, Carol Lawry, Basil Stewart, and Mike Pankew. Also, Aditya Jha came in Toronto. Thank you all for your support and for coming out and helping us. I think it was a very worthwhile initiative. The NCC is currently renewing its 2009 environmental strategy. In fact, we're reorienting our entire process to adapt to the new federal sustainable development strategy framework that's currently going through Parliament. Moreover, we're looking at ways that the NCC's environmental strategy can help foster or tie into a regional perspective on environmental sustainability. C'est pourquoi nous avons organisé quatre ateliers à l'intention des employés pour nous aider à harmoniser notre stratégie avec les 13 cibles fédérales et leurs objectifs connexes. Le prochain atelier est prévu pour le 8 décembre. Un atelier plus détaillé avec les parties prenantes est prévu pour le 30 novembre et nous recevrons alors les commentaires de nos interlocuteurs régionaux. Our intent is to present a draft sustainable development strategy to the public stakeholders and the advisory committee of the NCC in the spring of 2018. I'm really very pleased that the process for renewing the Gatineau Park Master Plan is now fully underway. Public consultation workshops were held in Ottawa on October 19th, and in Gatineau on November 1st, attended by about 200 people, as well as almost 1,000 people contributed input through an online survey. C'est la première des quatre étapes d'un projet qui mènera une vision revue et corrigée qui orientera la gestion du parc et assurera sa viabilité pour la prochaine décennie et les suivantes. D'autres séances publiques se tiendront en février pour passer en revue la vision pour le parc et discuter des principes directeurs et des objectifs stratégiques. Our goal is to have a draft of this plan completed in 2019, and I do encourage everybody to stay involved in this. I think it's an absolutely critical process for the future sustainability and success of the park. Moving on to specific programs in the park, the Fall Rhapsody was again a great success with many thousands of people visiting the park to enjoy the autumn colors. You'll recall we introduced a shuttle service a couple of years ago as a pilot, and we've extended it each year. It just grows in popularity, even despite the variable weather that we experienced this year. What was new this time is that the line was extended to pick up people in the Byward Market, so you could go from the urban core out into the park. And this carried more than 10,000 people into the park over the four weekends of the program. In fact, the downtown stop was the most important, most popular place for people to catch the shuttle. So I hope to further develop this project to extend public transit into the park on an even larger scale for the Colorado Terminal next year. I would also like to congratulate David Owen. David Owen is the winner of our Fall Rhapsody photo contest, and here is his wonderful photograph that you can see on the screen now. Seems like a deserving winner. Thank you to everyone who participated. Je veux aussi parler de la saison de foire d'automne qui se tient sur le terrain de la CCN. Le centre de visiteurs du parc de la Gatineau a de nouveau accueilli l'Anishinaabe Nibin ou l'été algonquin. Des centaines de personnes sont déplacées pour découvrir les traditions et la culture algonquin et voir des artisans à l'œuvre. Et pour la quatrième année consécutive, la CCN a collaboré avec la municipalité de Pontiac pour la tenue sa foire champêtre. Environ 1400 se sont rendus aux chutes de Luskville pour faire l'expérience de produits et services locaux et voir des exemples d'œuvres d'artistes de la région. Despite the inclement weather we experienced early in the summer, the number of people camping in the park, in fact, rose once again, passing our targets for the season. The overnight stays increased by 7% from 2016. This is partly due to the 150th celebrations, which had an early and obvious effect on bookings. But there were also good months in September, October that of exceptionally good weather that added to the numbers. Cette réussite est aussi le fruit du travail acharné de tous ceux et celles de la CCN qui ouvre à créer une expérience de camping exceptionnelle et je les remercie pour cette nouvelle saison record. Our fourth priority is to create lasting legacies and that serve as sources of pride for Canadians, including the official residences of Canada. And to start this on this priority, I would like to welcome on behalf of our board, our incoming Governor General, Her Excellency Julie Payette. Our chair, Mr. Seaman, and I had a very positive first meeting with the new Governor General, and we look forward to supporting her vision during her term at Rideau Hall. Nous avons hâte de travailler avec elle et son personnel au cours des mois et années à venir. With regard to the renewal of Nepean Point, this, of course, is one of the 17 milestone projects in the plan for Canada's capital. Four finalist teams presented their concepts to the public, to the Advisory Committee on Planning, Design, and Realty, and to the competition jury on October 5th. Canadians were also consulted through an online survey, which was completed by 550 people. I won't say more about this now because we'll hear a submission with the jury's recommendation later in the meeting, but I am delighted that this goal that we had set for 2017 has been achieved. The NCC's Confederation Pavilions program has been a true success this year, with more than 165 visitors taking the opportunity to experience these little-known architectural and historical treasures from the NCC's portfolio of heritage buildings. You'll recall most of these buildings were unused and empty for long periods of time, and they've come to life for 2017. Since our September meeting, the final three diplomatic missions participating in the International Pavilion have presented their exhibitions and activities. The Embassy of Hungary presented a wide variety of exhibits and activities, including an exhibition on Hungary's tradition of innovation and cutting-edge design, as well as a distinguished exhibition of Hungarian-Canadian art. They were a very active mission, and I think really enjoyed their stay at 7 Clarence. Ceci fut suivi de la présentation de la délégation de l'Union européenne, constituée d'une exposition de photographie de lieux patrimoniaux européens. And right now, the Embassy of the Republic of the Philippines is closing out the year of activities with a celebration of the diversity of Filipino culture, the Filipino diaspora, and the contributions of Filipino Canadians to this country. There are almost a million Filipino Canadians in Canada. They're a major part of our population. And if things go as the way they look, the beaver tail will eventually be overtaken by halo halo, which is the theme of their exhibition, which means mix mix, which is a metaphor for the multiculturalism of the Philippines. I encourage everyone to take an opportunity before December 8th, when the pavilion closes, to go see the building at 7 Clarence and visit the Philippines exhibition. En tout, 25 personnes ont participé aux événements tenus au pavillon international au cours de l'année. Je souhaite remercier toutes les missions diplomatiques participantes. Elles ont été des partenaires exemplaires. Looking at the entire Confederation Pavilions Initiative, I'm looking forward to coming back to the board with a full report on how the team and our partners took the 10 underused assets and brought them to life. I think they will be a wonderful legacy for 2017, including the O'Brien House, which will open near the end of the year and will be an ongoing legacy from 2017 as the Canadiana Pavilion. And I think opening O'Brien will be a fitting conclusion to the portfolio of NCC projects for 2017. Il y a un caractère cyclique à ces legs. Le premier pavillon à être inauguré soit le pavillon d'hiver à Rideau Hall sera accessible au public pour une deuxième saison de patinage à compter du 2 décembre, bien sûr si les conditions météorologiques le permettent. Although I should say it is a refrigerated rink, so the chances are good that skating will start at Rideau Hall on the 2nd of December. And for those who haven't seen the pavilion and the exhibition of winter at Rideau Hall, it's a nice experience. I'm also very proud that the NCC was a catalyst to bring Mosaic Canada, the horticultural exhibition, to Jacques Cartier Park this year. It vastly exceeded our expectations, with more than 1.3 million visitors, surpassing the target of 800,000 originally expected, and bringing approximately $60 million as an economic impact to the region. À ma connaissance, ce fut la plus importante initiative du programme Canada 150 au pays, et les visiteurs tant du Canada que d'étrangers n'ont pas tari d'éloge à son endroit. Je tiens à féliciter Lise Cormier et toute l'équipe de Mosaic Canada, ainsi que le maire Pedno Jobin et la ville de Gatineau pour cette réussite hors de commune pour la ville. Il y a des pourparlers en cours entre diverses instances gouvernementales et d'autres partenaires sur la possibilité de reprendre l'activité l'an prochain. Si les discussions aboutissent sur une réédition de l'exposition, nous serons heureux de l'appuyer. The inauguration of the National Holocaust Monument on September 27th by the Prime Minister and Minister Joly marked the conclusion of an eight-year odyssey for the National Capital Commission in the creation of this remarkable testimonial to 6 million Jews killed in the Holocaust, as well as the contributions of Holocaust survivors to Canada. It has been a great honor for the NCC to work so closely with the dedicated funding council, who raised more than half of the funds for the monuments, as well as with the talented design team led by Manhattan architect Daniel Libeskind, Toronto photographer Edward Bertinsky, and Quebec landscape architect Claude Cormier. En sa qualité d'intendant de la capitale, la CCNM a la disposition du projet de terrain, surveiller la conception et la construction du monument et assume désormais la responsabilité de son entretien, de sa préservation et de sa gestion. To those who have not visited, I do encourage you to go. It's a remarkable experience. I believe it's fulfilled our original ambition 8 years ago to achieve an international level design at the highest level of international design. And indeed, it's attracting positive reviews in the architectural press all over the world. We're also pleased that the Department of Canadian Heritage has joined forces with us as the leader of national commemorations in the capital since 2017 to keep the monument open during the winter months. Regarding the site for the Afghanistan monument, as Ms. Stanley mentioned earlier, following the last board meeting, the Commission facilitated further discussions among the proponents that we understand will result in a revised proposal being brought forward to the board in the new year. Our fifth priority is to be a value-added partner in support of Canada's capital region. With respect to the Amazon HQ2 bid, the NCC was very pleased to participate in the team developing the proposal under the leadership of Mayor Watson. I'd like to commend Invest Ottawa for their leadership, which was an unprecedented collaboration involving many partners both in Ottawa and Gatineau. And we'll cross our fingers. Being a value-added partner for us means constantly improving our civic engagement, fostering further openness and transparency. One of our vehicles has been the Capital Urbanism Lab that Kay mentioned. This fall season launched with a well-attended session on socially inclusive public transportation. And we'd like to thank the Conference Board of Canada for co-hosting this session with us. It was followed by a session on focusing on heritage, particularly the legacy of Canada's centennial in 1967 on the built heritage in the capital. This event was associated with the joint annual conference of the Association for Preservation Technology, that's a large American group, and the National Trust for Canada, a large conference that was held here in October. We were pleased to help sponsor that and to also involve ourselves in the proceedings and to host the delegates on various NCC sites for tours and panel discussions. La plus récente conférence du Labo d'urbanisme avait pour thème la science publique et la recherche scientifique sur les terrains de la CCN. Permettez-moi de prendre un moment pour rappeler que depuis la création du Labo d'urbanisme de la capitale, nous avons pris fait et cause pour la recherche publique et reconnu son importance pour notre société. And I should say I'm very proud of our public scientists here at the Commission. They often work in the shadows, but their leadership in environmental sustainability and community engagement is truly exemplary. Next month, the Urbanism Lab will partner for the third consecutive year with Carleton University's Forum Lecture Series to present a session focusing on the way new tools and technology of image making and visualization are influencing urban design and planning. So I invite all of you to join us on December 4th at the National Gallery for a session that we call Imaging the City. I'm sure, again, we'll have another full house. In 2018, watch out for sessions on public diplomacy in capital cities, planning the sky, Canadian design as a cultural export, a session on urban sustainability, healthy neighborhoods, and our annual celebration of Indigenous placemaking in advance of the National Aboriginal Day. Our final, sixth and final priority is to demonstrate corporate excellence such that the NCC is recognized as an exemplary federal crown corporation and the steward of federal lands and assets. Since the Auditor General's special exam was shared with us early this year, the NCC staff have been moving ahead with an action plan, particularly with respect to addressing the issue of deferred maintenance. We have proceeded with extensive discussions with our government counterparts to advance this response to the Auditor General's report. Permettez-moi de rappeler au Conseil que l'ensemble du rapport est très favorable à la CCN dans son évaluation de 22 de 24 catégories visées. And before I conclude, that since this is our final meeting of 2017, I would like to congratulate the board and the staff of the NCC for their service to Canada in this important year. I believe that together we've created meaningful memories and legacies and increased the pride of Canadians in their capital. And so I wish everyone a wonderful conclusion to this signal year and happiest of holidays and peace and prosperity in 2018. And with that, I end my report. Thank you. Merci. Miigwech.
Merci beaucoup, Marc. C'est une grande liste d'activités et beaucoup d'exploits dans les deux derniers mois. Alors, félicitations et pour vous et ton équipe sur ces gros succès. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions pour Marc sur la liste d'activités? Okay, parfait. Sinon, on va bouger maintenant aux aspects régionaux. Si c'est correct, Mère... Maxime Penneau-Jobin, je vais demander à Mère Watson de faire la première présentation car je crois que tu dois partir pour une autre séance au centre-ville dans un couple de minutes. So Jim, Mère Watson will turn the word to you.
Yeah, thank you. Excuse me, I have to be back at City Hall for a Volunteer Ottawa exhibition that I'm supposed to open at 10, so thank you for allowing me to go first. Just a couple of things. You mentioned both the chair and the president, the Grey Cup festival and the game itself. This is a big economic boost to our city. In fact, the CFL estimates, or OSAG estimate, it was about $100 million into the economy for a seven-day period. Very difficult to get a room in a hotel, which is a good problem to have. And we have four major 2017 events still left. The Grey Cup obviously is one, the NHL outdoor game, the 67s versus the Olympique de Gatineau is the third, and the Roar of the Rings, which is the curling championship that will determine our Olympic teams, both men and women, takes place at the CTC in December. We also want to thank the NCC. We had this program called Canada Groves, which was a program that each member of council was able to consult with their communities and plant 150 Canadian maple trees in their ward with a large rock with the 2017 symbol on it, and a number of the sites were at NCC property, including I know on by the RA Center, and we appreciate the cooperation. Le Breton Flats, as you may know, yesterday at City Council, we approved the mandate, negotiating mandate, for lack of a better term, for the city manager, myself, to work with the NCC and Rendezvous Le Breton. And so that was an important milestone from our perspective to keep this very exciting project moving forward. The Amazon bid was a joint Gatineau-Ottawa bid, and it was really the first time in our recollection that the two cities had worked together on something of this significance, and we had competitors working with one another to put the bid together, the website, the bid book itself, as well as the video were top-notch. We know it's a uphill battle. We don't have the same economic levers that American cities have in terms of providing direct financial assistance, but it was certainly a very good exercise in all hands on deck, from the NCC to Gatineau to Ottawa to Invest Ottawa to the private sector, the not-for-profit sector, and I'm very proud of the work that we did. And now we and 300 other cities are waiting for that call. And I guess I won't go on any longer. We have obviously our LRT continues to move forward, and you know, when we do have challenges with land and access and so on, we sit down and talk with one another, and it seems to be working well. So I appreciate the cooperative attitude on this important city building project. Merci.
Thank you very much, Mayor Watson, and again, congratulations on a great year for Canada 150, but with a lot of activity still happening over the next month. I know you and your team will be extremely busy. And thank you for the ongoing engagement and collaboration with the NCC on numerous projects. I know Mayor Watson, you have to step out for a few minutes, so we'll excuse you. À ce point-ci, j'aimerais donner la parole à Mère Panot-Jobin.
Merci. Ça me fait plaisir d'être ici. Il y a toujours un élément de risque important dans une élection. Mais avant de commencer, je voudrais saluer la présence de Mike Duggan, conseiller municipal du secteur Elmer, qui assiste à la rencontre. Donc oui, je suis heureux d'être ici. Je veux souligner d'ailleurs que M. Watson était présent à la cérémonie de la sermentation. Ça a été toujours apprécié par les gens de Gatineau. Oui, ça a été une grosse année. Il s'est passé beaucoup de choses. On a commencé le nouveau mandat en pensant l'année dernière, en fait à cette année, parce qu'on a adopté des résolutions pour faciliter le retour de Mosaïculture l'année prochaine. C'est pas quelque chose qui est acquis. Il y a des discussions importantes avec les deux autres gouvernements. C'est quelque chose que la Ville ne peut pas faire seule. Par contre, il y a beaucoup de gens qui travaillent très fort pour qu'on y arrive parce que les retombées ont été et sont encore extraordinaires de visibilité pour la région. Je dirais même quand on parle des relations entre les deux villes, là, il y a énormément de gens qui ont découvert Gatineau, des gens d'Ottawa qui ont découvert Gatineau grâce à cette activité-là. On a aussi, et ça va se faire, mosaïque hivernale. C'est des sculptures de neige qui vont aussi s'installer au parc Jacques-Cartier. Les gens qui s'intéressent, je vous invite à aller voir Sculpture Harbin. Harbin, c'est la ville chinoise qui a développé une expertise là-dedans. Et ce qu'on voit dans les photos sur Internet, sur Harbin, ça ressemble à ce qu'on pourrait avoir à Gatineau. Ça va être extraordinaire. Oui, M. Watson a bien souligné le travail de collaboration entre les deux villes dans le dossier Amazon, qui, en fait, pour moi, c'était déjà en quelque sorte une victoire parce que c'était la première fois où tout le leadership économique des deux villes préparait un projet commun. Et la principale tâche, c'était de se dire les uns aux autres ce qu'on avait de bon. Là où on était compétent, c'était quoi les forces de chaque côté de la rivière pour avoir une soumission commune intéressante. Puis ça, je crois aussi que ça a aidé chaque côté de la rivière à un peu mieux se connaître au niveau du leadership économique. Puis comme M. Watson disait, c'est parfois des concurrents qui travaillaient ensemble pour essayer d'obtenir ça. Dans les élections, il y a eu un changement. En fait, il y a eu plusieurs changements. Il y a 5 préfets en Outaouais. Et il y a seulement moi qui étais là avant. Donc, les 4 sont des nouveaux. Il y a le préfet de MRC des Collines, si je ne m'abuse, va être choisi dans les prochains jours. Mais ça aussi, au niveau de la gouvernance puis des liens à faire avec la région, c'est un changement qui est assez important. Dans les grands enjeux qui vont nous occuper dans les prochains mois, c'est évidemment le transport en commun. On va avoir une première rencontre en début d'année, les deux villes, les deux sociétés de transport. Dans notre cas, on change aussi la présidence de la société de transport. C'est Mme Myriam Nadeau qui va occuper le poste. Et on va commencer des discussions sur l'arrimage entre des discussions plus formelles. Les discussions ont lieu depuis déjà un bon bout de temps, mais des discussions plus formelles dans le cadre d'un nouveau comité qui vont commencer. Et nous, de notre côté, on travaille fort pour faire traverser le train léger. Là, on a commencé toutes sortes de démarches pour que les deux côtés de la rivière aient la même technologie. Je terminerai en disant que aussi, on a vu commencer cet automne les travaux du comité consultatif de la Rive-Nord. Puis ça aussi, pour moi, c'est une bonne nouvelle pour Gatineau et pour la région.
Merci. Merci beaucoup, Maire, et encore félicitations sur ta réélection, mais aussi sur les gros exploits à Gatineau cette année. Et le futur, c'est très positif. Alors, félicitations. At this point in time, we'll turn to our next item on the agenda, which is the federal land use and design approval for the parliamentary precinct, center block. And we'll call up Dan Champagne to the podium. And we're just waiting for members of Public Works, is that it? So this might be an opportune time for anybody need to grab some coffee or water or a bio break. You're more than welcome to take some. So we'll pause. Oh, okay. Wait, everybody here. Dan, la parole est la vôtre quand vous êtes préparé, prêt pour partir.
Merci beaucoup. Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and CEO Dr. Christensen and board members. This is a pretty exciting day we have to present this year. And before starting the presentation, I do want to welcome from our guests at Public Services and Procurement Canada, our guest Jennifer Garrett. She is also the Director General leading the Centre Block Program team at the Parliamentary Precinct Branch. As we all know, PSPC's rehabilitation of the buildings on Parliament Hill is a major undertaking, and we have been doing a lot of preparatory work for the last few years with the rehabilitation of the Government Conference Centre for the Senate, the West Block now close to being completed, and of course works that will soon start on the East Block. Buildings on the south side of Wellington have also been renovated, such as 100 Wellington and the Sir John A. Macdonald Building. So the presentation is twofold. Jennifer Garrett will provide information on the work program for the rehabilitation of the center block. Secondly, in order for the NCC to be ready for the extensive works required for the center block rehabilitation, we developed a capital guiding interest to guide the advancement of PSPC's works and our review of the plans and designs in view of federal approvals. These will be presented as recommendations for your approval. Slide three, perfect. First, I will be speaking about the NCC's role, mandate, and responsibilities in this rehabilitation and construction project. The center block rehabilitation program will then be presented by PSPC. Finally, Lucie Bureau, our Director of Long Range Planning and Transportation, will go over the proposed NCC guiding capital interests and explain their specific purpose and use in the context of this project. Rehabilitating the center block will be the largest and most complex heritage rehabilitation project ever to be undertaken by the federal government. This project is an opportunity to protect, enhance, and modernize the seat of Parliament, leaving a long-lasting legacy for future generations to come. The NCC is one of the stakeholders in this project, and we are involved in many fronts. First, we have a mandate to prepare plans for and assist in the development, conservation, and improvement of the capital region in order that the nature and character of the seat of government of Canada may be in accordance with its national significance. We have a project approval authority and assume a planning coordinating role under the National Capital Act. We are responsible for the maintenance of the Parliamentary Precinct grounds. Through our approval responsibility, we have the mandate to review the design of all the interventions impacting specifically the exterior of the building and the grounds. On the other hand, the Federal Heritage Building Review Office, in addition to the scope of the work reviewed by the NCC, also has the mandate to provide recommendations on all heritage aspects, including the proposed alterations to the interiors of Center Block. The guiding capital interests that will be presented shortly will serve in helping us fulfill mostly our second role in this project. So I'll turn it over to Jennifer Garrett, who will provide the additional information and give you the context of also the project and moving forward. So Jennifer, thank you.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Christensen, and members of the board. As Dan said, my name is Jennifer Garrett, and I'm the Director General responsible for the execution of the Centre Block Rehabilitation Program. I am really excited to be here today to provide you with a high-level overview of our rehabilitation program that I hope will provide important context for the upcoming presentation of principles that will be presented here this morning. Before I begin, I think it's really important to thank the NCC staff for their support on this project. Early engagement and collaboration is key to getting a project of this magnitude and complexity right. NCC staff have clearly demonstrated their interest and commitment to working with PSPC to ensure that this project is successfully executed. So thank you very much. Next slide, please. This is the outline of my presentation for this morning, but before I launch into it, I need to do just a little bit of expectations management. I know that there is great interest and excitement to understand the details of this rehabilitation program. But truthfully, we aren't there yet. We don't have those details. In fact, we are only in the early stages of planning and execution for this program. Having said this, I want to assure you that this is just the first of many engagements that we will have with NCC staff, ACPDAR, and this board as we work through the planning and execution of this rehabilitation. Next slide, please. The center block has not received a major upgrade since it was rebuilt following the fire that destroyed it in 1916. The building is an architectural treasure and is in desperate need of rehabilitation. Much has changed since the building was constructed almost 100 years ago, from advances to technology, to evolving security threats, to climate change. Center Block is the seat of our government and needs to be modernized to ensure that it can support parliamentary functions for another 100 years. The vision established by the project team for this program reflects our intent to rehabilitate this heritage building, but modernize it as well so that it can effectively support government operations well into the 21st century. The Parliament buildings are immediately recognized across Canada and around the world for their dramatic architecture, but they are also recognized as a symbol of our strong linkage to democracy. Given their importance, a strategy known as the Long-Term Vision and Plan and its guiding principles were developed to inform and influence construction projects on Parliament Hill, including the center block rehabilitation. These guiding principles will be discussed in further detail later in this presentation. Much has been accomplished in support of the plan, but much remains to be done. This slide depicts completed, current, and planned work on Parliament Hill. I would like to draw your attention to the buildings shaded in blue, in particular, the West Block and the Center and the Government Conference Center, which are now under construction. The completion of West Block and the Government Conference Center will facilitate the decanting and rehabilitation of Center Block, which is depicted in red shading on this slide. Next slide, please. The scope of work for the restoration of the Center Block, including the Peace Tower, is extensive. And that might be an understatement, actually. More specifically, we will rehabilitate the exterior of the building and reinforce it to resist possible earthquakes. We will replace obsolete mechanical, electrical, and life safety systems. We will rehabilitate interior masonry, wood, plaster, frescoes, stained glass, and metals. Once complete, the project will also reinstate the landscape and implement architectural lighting. The project scope also includes an additional phase and construction of the Visitor Welcome Center complex, which will include a public concourse, space for materials handling, as well as infrastructure to better distribute heating and cooling. Once it is done, the complex will link the west, east, and center blocks underground. To facilitate decommissioning of the building and get ready for substantive construction on the center block, Peace Tower, and Visitor Welcome Center, a program of work known as the Enabling Projects is being executed. The type of work being executed ranges from the relocation of underground infrastructure to the construction of a temporary loading dock to service the West Block and the Visitor Welcome Center while Center Block is under construction. The Center Block is an architectural treasure that belongs to all Canadians. While it is beautiful, the structure and systems hidden beneath the heritage finishes are in very poor condition. Photographs on the following two slides are intended to provide the board with a sense of the current condition of the building. So I won't take you through all the photos, but as an example, the photo in your top left identifies a decorative stone element that is completely now missing from the exterior masonry. We have outdated mechanical systems and rusting of the roof. The roof is completely degraded. Next slide, please. The photo on your right is the memorial chamber, and we have systematic structural cracking there that will need to be addressed throughout the rehabilitation. Next slide, please. This slide articulates the long-term vision and plan guiding principles in further detail. These principles provide a thoughtful foundation for the long-term vision and plan and confirms the change that change must occur in a balanced and measured way to give Parliament a setting worthy of the important work undertaken there while preserving these important national treasures for future generations. As a demonstration of the project's commitment to deliver excellence and align with the long-term vision and plan guiding principles, the project team has pushed these principles further and developed, in consultation with our parliamentary partners, a series of guiding values which will influence decision-making throughout the planning and execution of the rehabilitation program. Next slide, please. As previously indicated, we are still very early in the planning and execution of the Center Block program. Before any substantive construction starts, several key milestones must be met, which will be our focus over the 2017 to 2019 timeframe. Specifically, we will complete an extensive investigation program to examine the interior and exterior of the building to clearly identify the scope and complexity of work that is required. We will complete the enabling projects program that I referenced earlier to facilitate substantive construction, and we are already engaged with NC staff and Aquadar regarding construction site concepts. Lastly, but not least, we are in process of confirming functional program requirements with our parliamentary partners that will enable the development of a schematic design for both the Center Block and the Visitor Welcome Center that will form the foundation to support parliamentary functions for the next 100 years. You're already there. Okay, good. Thank you. Visitor experience. So, PSPC, this is a very important slide for us. PSPC and the project team fully understands the importance of Parliament Hill to tourism and our economy. The project team is operating under a business as usual philosophy and is working extremely hard with other government stakeholders and parliamentary partners to ensure that a positive visitor experience on Parliament Hill is maintained throughout the construction period. For example, during construction, the Great Lawn, where many key events on Parliament Hill take place, will continue to be available. The flag on the Peace Tower will continue to fly, and the changing of the guard will continue as well. Not to mention the picture of the Centennial Flame, which is on your slide, will continue to burn. Next slide, please. In conclusion, the project is more than just rehabilitating one of Canada's best examples of mid-19th century Gothic revival architecture. Because the Center Block is more than just a building. It is a national symbol and the heart of our parliamentary democracy, and it belongs to all Canadians. PSPC is committed to ensuring the Centre Block honors Canada's past and provides a legacy for our nation's future. We are building a team of competent professionals that understand what this project means for Canadians. I speak from my heart when I say that we all feel privileged to have the opportunity to work on this once-in-a-lifetime project. Next slide, please. I will close my presentation with an image of the construction of the new center block, post-1916, showing what was then a state-of-the-art hybrid masonry and steel building construction approach. It is also interesting to see the construction site fencing hoarding and temporary facilities. Perhaps it provides a hint of what the site might look like in a few years. This concludes my presentation. Thank you very much for your time this morning.
So now we will be presenting the guiding principles, and this is what is before you for approval. I will continue my presentation in French, so I'll leave you the time to plug your things. Alors, les intérêts directeurs de la capitale, s'ils sont approuvés aujourd'hui, deviendront la référence pour l'analyse des propositions déposées en vue de l'obtention des approbations fédérales. Ce sera un avantage pour Services publics et Approvisionnement Canada de connaître les règles du jeu en matière de qualité à l'avance, afin que les équipes de design travaillent toutes dans la même direction. Plusieurs demandes d'approbation seront soumises pour analyse au cours des prochaines années. Certaines seront présentées au conseil d'administration, d'autres seront de moins grande envergure et seront présentées pour approbation à notre comité au comité directeur du conseil d'administration. Donc, ces intérêts directeurs serviront à assurer une cohérence dans l'analyse et dans les décisions. Ça permettra de maintenir la même approche tout au long du projet, malgré la durée du projet, malgré les changements potentiels de personnel ou de membres du conseil d'administration. Les projets seront évalués selon ses intérêts lorsqu'ils seront rencontrés et les propositions seront présentées. Je recommence. Les projets seront évalués selon ses intérêts de la capitale et lorsque ces intérêts seront rencontrés, les propositions vous seront présentées pour approbation. Alors, c'est une approche qui est, nous le sommes convaincus, un gage de succès. Nous avons établi trois familles d'intérêts, soit les principes fondamentaux, ceux applicables pendant la construction et ceux applicables au projet final. Je ne présenterai qu'un sommaire de l'ensemble des intérêts qui se retrouvent, bien sûr, dans vos documents. En premier, nous avons les principes fondamentaux. Ils constituent ceux qui s'appliquent à l'ensemble et qui permettent d'élever les discussions au niveau des principes réellement et qui nous amènent à valider et à renforcer les idées principales qui soutiennent les autres catégories. Le premier principe vise la recherche d'équilibre entre les besoins fonctionnels et le patrimoine. Il est possible que l'ensemble des demandes ait un impact sur certains éléments du patrimoine et ce principe permettra de bien cadrer les discussions. L'édifice du centre est un symbole des plus significatifs pour les Canadiens et les Canadiennes. Le deuxième nous parle de la nécessité de maintenir une vision à long terme, telle que le prévoit le plan à long terme pour la colline, de maintenir l'ensemble des composantes de la colline dans une harmonie, les bâtiments, le paysage et l'ensemble des bâtiments du côté sud de la rue Wellington. Ce principe se réfère aussi à la protection et à la mise en valeur de l'existant. Le troisième nous rappelle que ce lieu est et doit demeurer un paysage culturel dans le paysage naturel et bâti qui se complètent. On vise également, par le quatrième principe, à examiner toutes les propositions avec la lunette d'amélioration de l'accessibilité pour les visiteurs, bien sûr tout en tenant compte des impératifs de la sécurité. Finalement, et non le moindre, de faire de ce projet du siècle un projet inclusif et riche de sens, tel que nous le dicte le plan de la capitale du Canada, qui est notre plan guide à très long terme. C'est un projet qui va permettre de rassembler tous les Canadiens et toutes les Canadiennes autour de ce grand projet et qui devra continuer de représenter le Canada de demain, incluant tous les Canadiens. Les deux autres catégories d'intérêt regroupent des thèmes communs, mais comme la phase de construction durera de nombreuses années, au-delà de ce qu'on considère normalement comme étant temporaire, et considérant l'importance de ce site, il nous est apparu essentiel d'évaluer les projets selon des intérêts spécifiques pendant la période du chantier. Ensuite, je vous présenterai les grands principes pour le projet final. Commençons avec l'expérience des visiteurs, l'accès du public et les communications. Les principes de cette catégorie visent, dans la mesure du possible, à préserver la qualité de l'expérience des visiteurs et de s'assurer que l'esprit du lieu soit conservé, malgré le fait que le site sera en partie en construction pour une période de temps assez longue. Les principes dans la catégorie des événements et commémorations visent à permettre, encore une fois dans la mesure du possible, la poursuite de la tenue d'événements qui ont traditionnellement lieu sur la colline, ainsi que de donner accès aux différents monuments autour du chantier. Jennifer Garrett en a parlé, donc les objectifs sont partagés par les deux organisations. La relève de la garde, par exemple, pourra se poursuivre. Les principes sous l'excellence en design sont reliés à l'esthétisme du site pendant la période de construction. Ce chantier ne sera pas un chantier ordinaire et nous travaillons avec l'équipe de projet et les autres intervenants afin de tirer parti de cette situation en trouvant des façons par le design pour animer le site et pour susciter la participation et la fierté du public. La qualité des clôtures et des bâches recouvrant l'édifice du centre doit refléter l'importance de ce site. Dans cet esprit, l'utilisation d'un trompe-l'œil est recommandée. Les principes dans la catégorie de la conservation du patrimoine comprennent les énoncés qui sont reliés aux méthodes de conservation du patrimoine naturel et bâti, aux pratiques archéologiques et à la gestion des collections, qui soient à la fine pointe des meilleures pratiques au monde et en conformité avec les recommandations des divers groupes d'experts qui contribueront au projet. La catégorie de la protection de l'environnement et la durabilité inclut les énoncés visant à diminuer la pollution lumineuse pendant la période de construction, à protéger dans la mesure du possible les armatures et à suivre la stratégie fédérale de développement durable. Les quelques prochaines diapos présentent les principes qui vont être appliqués lors de l'analyse du projet final. Cette première catégorie indique que le projet final devra être conforme à l'ensemble des plans et des politiques fédérales applicables à ce site. Vous en voyez quelques-unes à l'écran. La liste complète se retrouve dans vos documents. Donc, le plan de la capitale du Canada, le plan du cœur de la capitale, le plan à long terme sur la colline parlementaire sont quelques-uns de ces exemples. Les principes sous la catégorie de l'excellence du design font appel aux meilleures pratiques dans tous les champs d'expertise interpellés par ce projet pour permettre une intégration réussie et de qualité des nouvelles interventions aux bâtiments et aux paysages existants. Les principes de la catégorie de la conservation du patrimoine visent à donner les orientations pour la protection et la gestion des composantes patrimoniales, incluant l'archéologie, les paysages culturels et les bâtiments. La colline, vous le savez, est un lieu historique national du Canada et il est aussi classé comme édifice fédéral du patrimoine. Bon, l'image que vous voyez représente le futur centre des visiteurs de la colline qui est localisé à l'ouest de l'édifice du centre. Les principes sous la catégorie de l'excellence des visiteurs, de l'expérience des visiteurs et l'accessibilité universelle nous rappellent l'importance de protéger ce site comme un symbole national et comme lieu des plus significatifs pour la tenue d'événements nationaux pour tous les Canadiens et Canadiennes, incluant ceux avec des problématiques d'accessibilité. Et la dernière catégorie regroupe les principes de la protection de l'environnement et la durabilité, visant à s'assurer que la conformité du projet, que le projet sera conforme à toutes les lois et politiques provinciales, fédérales en matière d'environnement, incluant bien sûr la stratégie fédérale de développement durable. Avant de passer à la diapo des recommandations, un simple rappel des prochaines étapes. Donc, une fois que ces intérêts de la capitale seront approuvés, si c'est votre intention, membre du Conseil, nous sommes confiants de pouvoir continuer à travailler avec Service public à la réalisation de ce projet unique. Nous vous soumettrons les éléments du projet au fur et à mesure qu'ils seront prêts et que nous serons en mesure de les recommander pour approbation fédérale. En conclusion de cette présentation, je vais donc faire la lecture des deux recommandations qui sont devant vous pour décision. Donc, que l'approbation fédérale de l'utilisation du sol et du design soit octroyée pour les intérêts directeurs de la capitale concernant le projet de restauration de l'édifice du centre dans la cité parlementaire et que la préparation et la signature du document d'approbation fédérale pour les intérêts directeurs de la capitale soit déléguée au directeur général aménagement de la capitale. Nous sommes bien sûr tous disponibles pour répondre à vos questions. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Lucie. Thank you very much, Jennifer. At this point, we'll turn it to members of the board for questions to either Jennifer, Lucie, or Dan. So we'll start with Bob, then we'll move to Mike.
Thank you for the presentation, and welcome, Jennifer. I have a high degree of confidence that the government is committed, the country is committed to preserving the which I think is the most iconic building in all of Canada. So I'm very reassured by everything that I've heard this morning, and I'm gratified to hear that the lawn will remain open, that the flag will fly, that the flame will burn. I think this is really important given the duration of this project. I just wanted to point out what I saw was this, I think it may have been tongue-in-cheek, but a little disconnect between what you were saying about the hoarding from the picture in 1910 of, you know, an example of what the hoarding might be and the example that was put forward on the slide by the NCC staff, which was something that was actually quite architectural significant and pleasing, because no doubt millions of pictures will be taken from the Wellington Street looking up at that construction site, and we're all hoping not to see scaffolding and the like, but something that actually demonstrates a certain amount of creativity, even if it does require a certain investment, which I think will pay off given the length of the project. And I know every now and then there's criticism about a lack of hoarding or money that's spent on hoarding, but I just wanted to ask for your comments on what you see as you know, your vision for the what we will see, what the visitors will see over the decade or so that this the construction is ongoing. Thank you.
Is that on? Right?
Yes.
Thank you for your question, and I appreciate the tongue-in-cheek comment about the existing construction sites. So just to clarify my comments and the photo that you saw of the building while it was under construction, we do understand the importance of Parliament Hill to the visitor experience and the impact that center block construction will have on that and that, on the hill. So that's why we're working very hard to keep activities in a business as usual approach on the hill during that construction. Having said that, and for more explicitly to your point, we are taking very seriously the opportunity to communicate the project to Canadians, because we think for the duration that the center block will be under construction, it's important that Canadians have an understanding and are engaged in that process. So while I can't tell you what our vision is, because we're still working on that vision, what I can tell you is that we will use site construction and opportunities like the hoarding to communicate and the tarping to communicate the project in a way that is befitting of the dignity of Parliament Hill, and so that Canadians can fully engage in the visitor experience process, but it may be in a different way when they come to Parliament Hill to see Centre Block. We should have more details on that in a spring time frame, but honestly, we're really at the strategy stage at this point. Does that help?
That helps.
Thank you, Jennifer. Great response. Mike?
Thank you for the presentation. It may have helped Bob, but your explanation didn't help me. my expectation is that there will be something that will resonate architecturally from design in terms of people being proud of what's going on as opposed to looking at a bunch of flapping white tarp. We've been advised and we've seen examples of excellent buildings, iconic buildings across Europe that are presented through the construction period in a very aesthetically pleasing fashion. That wasn't my question. My question is specific to universal access. this is, and you're quite right, this is a building for all Canadians. In Western Canada, when I try to explain to colleagues and people in the public what the NCC is and what its responsibilities are, their eyes kind of glaze over until we talk about the Parliament precinct and we talk about 24 Sussex. I think Canadians across the country understand the importance of these buildings, both in terms of function and in terms of symbolism. And your point about the decisions we make today will have to serve us for the next 100 years are absolutely correct. When we look at the guidelines, there's a reference of compliance to Canada CSA B651, you know, which basically means nothing to most people. But it's very important for people who need to access, need to be able to experience the Parliament precinct in every way possible. Compliance isn't good enough, I think, if we're looking 100 years into the future. And I would ask you whether you will be working with your consultants, your architects, your interior design people, to come up with proposals and implement those proposals that anticipate what the requirements are going to be 25, 50, 100 years down the road. Not a compliance. We checked it off. This document that was presented in 1995 and updated in 2010 and thereafter is going to be sufficient. So my question really is specifically, what type of direction will you be providing, regardless of these guidelines, to your consultants with respect to universal access?
Thank you for your question, and I would agree with you that those guidelines are the baseline. In terms of our commitment on the Centre Block Rehabilitation Program, our commitment is strong in this regard, and I would draw everybody's attention to our Minister's mandate letters that are within the public domain, and the most recent mandate letter, which actually said that we would exceed standards in terms of universal accessibility and sustainability. So we are committed to working very closely. This is not a check in the box for us, and we will work very closely with our design team to ensure that we have a vision and that we look forward and that we do our very best to meet and exceed those standards. Having said this, this will be a challenge. I want to say that very clearly. We're not talking about a new construct in the case of the Centre Block and the Peace Tower. So this is not going to be, this will be a very big challenge for us and a significant undertaking. But I think we have composed the right competencies and support to get it right. So we're early stages. We're far from schematic design and having those details. But I want to assure you we are committed.
Thank you, Jennifer. Kay?
I'm in support of the recommendation. I also recognize, Jennifer, we're going to see a lot of you in the coming months. But I was just thinking, as you were showing the illustrations of where some of the deficiencies are, about the capacity and the competence level with the skilled trades, et cetera. I mean, part of this will be not only the contracts, but, you know, do we have the talent in terms of stonemasons and all of the artisans that will be needed, or are we engaged in a program to attract people with these talents from other parts of the world? I mean, is somebody looking at the capacity of our workforce to meet the challenges that are being outlined in this submission?
The answer to that question is yes, absolutely, we are looking at that. From a positive perspective, execution of the long-term vision and plan and the construction that's been driven onto Parliament Hill in recent years has actually generated some capacity in the market, but Centre Block will need a lot more capacity than what exists. And there's, in general terms, going to be a lot of construction activity happening concurrently with other projects. So we are deliberately looking at the trades that we require. and will be working with our construction manager to form strategies on how we intend to draw those trades. If necessary, we're prepared to make partnerships early on, and we're actually engaged in several strategic partnerships with, for example, Carleton University as a key one, to ensure that we have the capacity in the market to have those trades available to us. Now, having said that, you don't want to build something that you can't sustain. So where we do influence capacity in the market, we want to make sure there's an enduring capability in terms of jobs for Canadians. So it's a very delicate process. We're at the early stage, but we see this as a challenge, and we're working on it now to make sure that we're ready.
Thank you, Jennifer. Any other questions or comments? We have Mike, then Bob.
Thank you. This is a long project. These guidelines, which I think are good, are a snapshot in time. Do we have a process in place for modifications to these to this document if we collectively agree that they can be improved, made better, represent something that we haven't anticipated 5 years down the road?
I think the way with the construction management approach, there's a continuous improvement loop as they go through their process and their construction techniques and the end result. So I leave it in the hands of PSPC as experts in doing this, and the refinement that they do, and that they follow all the newest techniques that are available to them. So I the answer would be yes.
Maybe to complement the answer, yes, if we need to modify those guiding principles, we will come back to the board for and recommend an amendment to these guiding principles if need be.
Thank you, Jennifer. Yep.
I'd just like to jump in on that one. So we're committed, if there is a requirement that NCC staff identify, to change those guiding principles. But if I could, from a PSP perspective, given the duration of the program, the whole point of bringing these guiding principles to you was to provide some stability in terms of oversight to the decision making as we launch for the program. So I'm hoping, I make a commitment on PSPC side, that we are going to try and innovate and deliver the program in the best way that we know how. But in terms of oversight of the program, we're hoping that these guiding principles actually won't change dramatically over the course of the renovation, just in fairness.
Thank you. So we will, Bob has a question. I think it's directed to Mark. We'll also ask Mark to have some closing remarks before we move to the vote. I think you've also heard very clearly from the board the importance of the tarping and the visitor experience, not just the visitor experience, but also local citizens that live in this community, how important it is because of the duration of the project to ensure that there is a sustainable solution to the experience and the actual visibility of the renovation. So we'll turn it to Bob, then I believe Mayor Watson has a question as well.
Just speaking on the visitor experience, over this summer, the two questions I got asked most frequently, one was about, you know, where can I get to Mosaic Canada, and is it really as outstanding as I've heard? So that I got heard, I was asked frequently. The second question was, when will the path behind Parliament Hill be reopened, you know, following the flood? So my question is, will the path behind Parliament Hill be open and accessible during the entire construction period, or are we looking at a closure of that path because of the consequence of construction?
No, the path will be open. You're talking about the path that is close to the river, at the riverside, that will be open. The project does not impact that pathway.
Thank you, Lucy. Mayor Watson.
Obviously, I missed the presentation. I apologize, but I just want, and I believe Michael told me this issue was raised, but to emphasize the importance of having not just scaffolding on the most photographed building in the country is very important to our tourism industry, and I know there's a cost to it. There's a cost to to everything, but I think it's very, very important that that message be brought back to public works. I can't remember what the new name of the department is, but I had a meeting with Michael Crockett, who is the Ottawa Tourism President, and former Minister Foote, I guess about 2 years ago now, where we went to see her specifically to ensure that there was going to be some kind of treatment to the screening that looked like the Parliament buildings, for instance. I just wanted to put that on the record that it's very important to the third largest industry in our city and our region, the tourism and hospitality industry. So thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Watson. I think it emphasizes the points that we've been making. I think the message has been loud, heard loud and clear. So if there are no other questions, I will be turning it over to Mark to have some closing comments, and we'll move it to a vote.
Great, thank you. Well, it's great that we've got here today. It took a while to get this in the gate, and so thank you for bringing it. And I know that the teams have been working well together over the past months, and there's been a productive relationship. But I think what doesn't really come through in the presentation for me is that you're developing an international center of excellence in this domain, and having, unlike others, the privilege of touring some of the sites that have been worked on and so forth. And I just look back on the Sir John A. Macdonald building, the Wellington building, which is a beautiful expression, what's happening at the Government Conference Center for the Temporary Senate, and particularly the West Block, which I had a chance to visit last week. When you add up all these projects, Public Services and Procurement Canada, I think, are creating a center of excellence for this, and I come away very encouraged and very proud as a Canadian, really, that, compared to some other countries and the troubles they have with their parliamentary precincts and trying to get alignment, and it's been a long time coming. It's been, even decades in the making, but we're seeing the fruition of an awful lot of hard work by, and so even to answer your question a little bit, Kay, I was impressed by the trades and what's been evolving in stonework and so forth that will all feed into this project. The other thing that I asked the leadership at Public Services was how are we doing as a challenge function with the Advisory Committee on Planning, Design, and Realty and the board? And although we were a pain sometimes, they did admit that. They did say that the challenge function works, that there are improvements. And when you have a chance to see the temporary parliament, which isn't going to be so temporary, it's a decade-long project, I think you'll see that the comments that came from the ACPADAR committee and through the board have been taken into account and have really made the scheme exceed expectations. So I would encourage the group to continue in that spirit of creativity, because I think what I came away with from the West Block is that you not only took what was said, but took it further. And I think that will happen and can happen in the center block. Finally, I will just say that the treatment of the temporary treatments that Mayor Watson talked about, I really commend you to think about that, and feel free to come to the ACPADAR committee if you want to do a workshop. I think the most successful instance of this here has been the iceberg so far at the National Gallery that I think people didn't even know that was tarpaulins covering a work project on the Great Hall. It became an iconic source of visitation in itself. So there are many ways to do this. We'd be happy to help. And then also to feel free to use our resources to look at this long term and keep evolving the long term vision towards that excellence that Canadians, I think, not only expect but will see based on the track record you're creating. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. So thank you very much, Kay. Is there a seconder? Bob, all in favor? Great. Any opposed? So the motion is carried. Thank you very much. Jennifer and Lucy, thank you very much. Very thorough presentation. It's a massive but very important undertaking, and we appreciate your leadership. Thank you very much. So, Dan, on va rester avec vous pour la présentation maintenant sur... On va changer? Okay. Well, we're going to take a five-minute break since we are ahead of schedule, so while we transition speakers. So we will resume at 10:40. Okay, we're going to proceed with our board meeting, and to the next items, the final item on the agenda for this morning. Alors, à ce moment, on va demander à Dan de nous présenter le réaménagement de la pointe Napine, l'approbation du concept gagnant. Alors, Dan, la parole est la vôtre encore.
Merci encore. Well, some more exciting news again this morning. We're here to announce the recommended concept from the Nepean Point International Design Competition. I'd like to introduce the NCC project team who managed the design competition, Yolande Charette, Chief Landscape Architect and Industrial Design, Anne-Carole Beauregard, Project Manager, Landscape Architect, Kelly Warnarski, our Landscape Architect, as well as Janet McGowan, Project Coordinator. Now, before we unveil the recommended concept, I'm going to turn it over to Pierre Vaillancourt, the Director of Design and Construction, who will provide additional background on the design and competition. I'm going to pull myself away because I want Yolande to come up and provide some insight as well. So, excuse me.
Merci, Daniel. Voici un rappel du contexte. La pointe Nepean est au cœur de la capitale. Située à proximité du Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada et du Parc Majors Hill, ce lieu offre des vues spectaculaires vers la colline parlementaire. La vision. La CCN a identifié la nécessité d'aménager ce site puisque les aménagements existants ont atteint leur fin de cycle de vie. La pointe Nepean deviendra une destination à caractère culturel grâce à son histoire, ses magnifiques œuvres d'art et points de vue. À la fois actif et contemplatif, la pointe Nepean aura toutes les caractéristiques d'un pôle d'activité accessible, connecté et dynamique. Les objectifs. Les objectifs de ce projet visent à maintenir le statut iconique du monument Samuel de Champlain, rendre plus visibles les portes d'entrée du parc de la pointe Nepean pour en faciliter l'accès, créer un parc pittoresque offrant des vues sur le paysage et la rivière des Outaouais, créer une destination pour une clientèle variée. Le concours international de design. En janvier 2017, la CCN a lancé un concours international de design. Le processus de sélection s'est déroulé en deux étapes. Dans un premier temps, la CCN a invité les architectes paysagistes à former une équipe composée de quatre personnes provenant des disciplines de l'architecture du paysage, de l'architecture ou de l'urbaniste, de l'ingénierie de pont et d'une autre discipline de leur choix. Un jury composé d'experts a procédé à l'analyse des 26 propositions reçues pour retenir quatre équipes qui ont proposé dans la deuxième étape un concept d'aménagement. Le jury. Le jury était composé de Monica Bitancourt, architecte paysagiste de la Commission de la Capitale-Nationale du Québec, George Dark, architecte paysagiste et urbaniste conseil de la firme Urban Strategies, Marc Maillet, directeur général du Musée des Beaux-Arts du Canada, John McNee, premier secrétaire du Centre mondial du pluralisme, Alfred Waugh, architecte autochtone de grande renommée de la firme d'architecture Formline. Le jury a suivi un processus d'évaluation selon plusieurs critères incluant la vision, le design et les concepts directement en lien avec les objectifs de ce projet. Le comité technique. Plusieurs professionnels et experts de la CCN ont étudié les quatre propositions sous les aspects suivants. L'architecture du paysage, l'ingénierie, l'éclairage, l'impact environnemental, les coûts et l'accessibilité universelle. La consultation publique. Le 5 octobre, plus de 200 visiteurs ont assisté à la soirée porte ouverte de la CCN. Le public fut invité à rencontrer les finalistes et à commenter les concepts présentés. Entre le 5 et le 18 octobre dernier, 541 personnes ont donné leur opinion par le biais du site web de la CCN. Les limites du site. Les limites du site du concours illustrent le site prioritaire à construire, c'est-à-dire la phase 1, identifiée comme la pointe Nepean, qui représente une superficie d'environ 2,5 hectares. Les phases subséquentes, identifiées comme le pont piétonnier et l'entrée Sainte-Patrick, sont situées à gauche. La partie intitulée « Entrée Sussex » demeure la propriété du Musée des Beaux-Arts et pourra être aménagée par le musée. Un budget de construction de 6,7 millions est allouée pour la première phase de construction. Les coûts reliés aux phases subséquentes ne sont pas encore identifiés à ce point. Voici les quatre concepts présentés par les équipes finalistes. L'équipe WAA Montréal avec la proposition intitulée Parc Nogoche-Cadawin. L'équipe est composée de membres provenant des régions de Montréal et d'Italie. L'équipe West 8 avec la proposition intitulée La Pointe Bluff. L'équipe est composée de membres provenant des régions des Pays-Bas et d'Ottawa. L'équipe de Janet Rosenberg, avec la proposition intitulée « Paysage de la Grande Rivière ». L'équipe est composée de membres provenant des régions de Toronto et de Vancouver. L'équipe Public Work, avec la proposition intitulée « Un parc pour notre pays en devenir ». L'équipe est composée des membres provenant de la région de Toronto. Et la proposition recommandée est le concept intitulé « Paysage de la Grande Rivière » réalisé par l'équipe Janet Rosenberg and Studio Inc.
A piece of the planned riverwalk is constructed along the edge of Nepean Point. Circle Rock is a small gathering plaza at the south entrance of the new bridge over St. Patrick's Street. The statue of the Anishinaabe Scout occupies its center. A pedestrian path loops around the National Gallery. This art loop is reinforced with new sites for art, both permanent and temporary. An extended taiga garden has a boardwalk running through it, leading visitors to the art loop experience. As a new way of drawing people into the many cultural offerings of Nepean Point, new sites are spaced so that from one, you can see the next. A sheltered theater for performances of all kinds is grounded within a grassy mound. To either side of the theater, paths flow towards a high plateau. Whispering Point is tucked in under the plateau and is sheltered, a place totally focused on the river. Its wall whispers stories in your ear, stories of millennia-long habitation of this land. Moving up a hill past the theater, views open in all directions. While the plateau feels like a center in space, it has its own center, one that is grounded, the Gathering Circle, a spectacular place for events of all kinds.
Merci. Les principales recommandations du jury et du CCUDI. Il y avait plusieurs recommandations du jury et du CCUDI, mais les plus significatives sont considérer le pont piétonnier de même que les entrées sur Sussex et Saint-Patrick comme prioritaires. Le paysage du parc doit être un site de verdure du patrimoine actuel et futur d'Ottawa. Réévaluer la vocation de l'amphithéâtre. Calendrier du projet. Les prochaines étapes sont avril 2018, raffinement du concept et des estimations de coûts, et automne 2020, la fin des travaux de la phase 1. La recommandation. La CCN recommande au conseil d'administration d'approuver le choix du jury fait par le jury de la proposition intitulée « Paysage de la Grande Rivière » soumise par Janet Rosenberg and Studio Inc. comme concept gagnant pour le réaménagement de la pointe Népine, sous réserve d'un raffinement du concept et de la stratégie de mise en œuvre du projet en vue de l'approbation du conseil d'administration à l'été 2018. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Pierre. Est-ce qu'il y a des questions pour Pierre ou l'équipe de les membres? Any questions from the members to Pierre or the team? If not, then is there someone that can put a... Oh, we have Kay.
I'm curious, when you say reevaluate the amphitheater situation, because I went back and looked at their submission and I couldn't find... I know they talked about reform the point and sustain a process place, but I couldn't find any specific language in the submission. And I don't recall from the day that they were here, because I was an observer at the ACPIDAR meeting. So what is meant by reevaluate the amphitheater?
Maybe I'll take that one. The NCC about probably almost 7 years ago, did a small stakeholder survey of all the festivals in Ottawa about how much interest there would be in reinvesting in the amphitheater on Nepean Point. And the essence of that study was that the large festivals couldn't see how they could incorporate it into their programs, which are very gated and site-specific, but there were small festivals that were interested in using it as an amphitheater. So therefore, it was put in the competition guideline to keep the amphitheater. In the discussions with the jury, which you will have noticed included the directors of the National Gallery and the Global Pluralism Center, who are the neighbors, there was a real discussion about what level the amphitheater should be taken to, whether it should be more of a gathering place or a fully fitted up amphitheater. And the feeling was at the end of that discussion is we probably need to go back to stakeholders to test this out. What is the true need for that? Somewhere is it just a naturalized space that is a gathering space, or is it a fully equipped amphitheater for up to 500 people? And really, this is a kind of further market analysis that we'll need to do. But there wasn't a clear consensus on the jury that the amphitheater should be a main feature. So I guess when we say reevaluate, it's really to go back and understand the market better before we finalize with the design firm how far we're going to take that particular element.
Okay, you have a follow-up, and then Bob.
I remember the discussion with respect to Champlain and how high the Belvedere was, so, and because I like to stand at the Museum of History and look across and see him there, so was there anything specific in the proposal that would change the elevation of where Champlain is? Now that he has a partner in Chief Desowet on the other side, I hope he's still there.
The proposal that's presented today, I think there's a lowering. We're lowering the statue by 10 sitting meter only. So that's
that could
be adjusted.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Kay. Bob.
When we vote on this, if I could raise two hands, I would. What I want to just express is the exceptional enthusiasm that I have for this project and for the extraordinary work that the staff have done in bringing this together, and the exceptional contribution from the design community in bringing a lot of creativity to this project in ACPIDAR. The request for proposal that was put together by staff is a great story. It reads like a history book. It's probably the best RFP I have ever read in my life. It should be a case study. If you can submit it for an award, I would. It is simply outstanding. The submissions that we received from the community were creative, they were voluminous, it showed a great passion, I think, for Canada and the capital. These were all labors of love, and it was evident from going through the documents. The presentations themselves, I sat in at ACPIDAR, you know, it was captivating in every moment. It was really quite exceptional. And the variations in the design were really quite unique. And I came away thinking, well, we've got four winners here. difficult to pick one because they were all, you know, so exceptional. I'm grateful that the jury picked my favorite, so I can't argue with them as well. And also the flexibility on the part of the NCC team and staff in listening to the recommendations of the jury about phasing and priorities and the importance of the pedestrian bridge, which I think is absolutely critical. And it's something, of course, I know the budget has its limitations and we have to work within that. But, you know, to me, that is the priority for this project. And if there's if budget limitations suggest that there are elements that have to be put into phase two or three, I hope that in phase one, the pedestrian bridge holds true, which was, I think, the recommendation of the jury. So I'm going to vote one thumb up, two thumbs up. I think this was just an outstanding piece of work. And in the years to come, when they're writing about the Capitol and the 10 things you have to do when you come to the National Capitol, this is going to make the list for sure in the top 10 and maybe in the top 5, because the number of people who come to the Capitol, who live here, who've never been to Nepean Point kind of astounds me, because it represents, I think, the most exceptional view of the Capitol that we have. So I just wanted to express my appreciation and my admiration for the work that was done on this project. I think is just outstanding.
Thank you, Bob, for the enthusiasm. Carol.
I couldn't imagine, having gone and seen it, that they were going to produce something that was this lovely. I'm really quite impressed with it. I guess my concern is we have a certain amount of budget that we allocated before I even came on the board, I think, to do something at Nepean Point. The chart that you show suggests that the green part is what we're talking about now, or the dark green part. When you come back to us with this, will there be a more fulsome understanding of the financial implications of all of this? Because I get a sense that, like you, that the money we've voted so far is just for a part of it, and I'm a little concerned about voting for something that has a big picture that we don't quite know what the big picture is at this point.
Absolutely. These are the next steps of this project, is to consult with all the stakeholders involved, like City of Ottawa, like National Art Gallery, and to refine the concept and also refine the cost estimated for this project, including all the recommendations that we received from the jury, to include them part of the concept and to cost them also prior coming back to you for approval and present you like a full concept for the project.
So at this point, we're just voting to go with these people's concept, and that's...
The recommendation is to proceed and to refine the concept, to include all the recommendations that we received during consultations, and go back to you early, like in the new year.
Okay.
Thank you for the clarification, Pierre. So we'll put the motion. Yeah, and Bob, from your enthusiasm, you for the motion, thank you very much. Do we have a seconder? Aditya, all in favor? All right, that's motion is passed. Thank you very much. Unless we have any closing remarks, that ends our agenda an hour earlier than expected. So to everyone here, les membres des médias encore, merci encore pour être ici, votre enthousiasme pour la CCN, les membres du public. This is the last time we'll be seeing each other before the New Year, so to all, happy holiday season, safe holiday season, and we'll see you in the New Year. Thank you very much.